pigeon.
So aircraft were both rescued from scrapyards. Kittyhawk in particular by a bunch of teenagers who put their pocket money together and decided to hang on to it. For now, here we are as the opener for Warbirds Over Wanaka 2004. Keith Skilling leads in Ray Hanna in the Corsair and the P-40 Kittyhawk.
CJ1 jet, corporate jet, something that has actually disappeared from the skies in New Zealand over recent years. This corporate jet or the corporate aircraft seem to fade from the scene. We've got a company now which is operating from Christchurch, Pacific Jets, and they're offering the use of their jet at a price, of course. You probably have to be a film star, but I think they are actually aiming at film stars.
Now I've got a landing light on from the left. And if we look out there, low and what looks like fairly fast to me.
261.
Everyone, it's a great shot. Citation over the top of those two packs.
Flying by two ex-RNZAF Skyhawk pilots, Chris Hutchison, and local Wanaka boy Rob Fluitt. Round them to a steep turn, max rate turn. The aircraft has six passenger seats. Certain where they're going to be doing this, possibly over by the
That was a bit faster at landing, I think. And here we go. Now I've seen these guys before. It's a lovely display. They're going to take off and I think hold while we go.
Let's go. Helicopter that controls the round and round parts of the flight. Rotors above the cabin control the rest of the flight.
Clamshell doors, been particularly the two brothers, John in Richmond, their father started at his own time one.
Display, I think, Ray, is unique throughout the world.
Yes, most certainly. The pilots, we started the company, we had two pilots who invented formation flight on the way home from work. The brothers carried it on, they did the flight. Just John Harding over the sorry, 29,800 hours. Now, in those days, in the 1950s and 1960s, in even office time, the ferry flight was just going to be fine. So, these 12 seasons, 30,000 hours, the country's in New Zealand, and
that's a lot of hours, 30,000 hours.
Skydiving role, the aircraft has maximum passengers at 13. Of course, it hasn't got the hopper in it. There's a big door in the rear end for loading freight and, of course, exiting skydivers. But the 10 skydivers, it can get to 12,000 feet in 8 minutes. That's pretty good performance for a so-called light aircraft. But up to 15,000 feet, it will give the free fall is a minute free fall, so in that respect it's quite exciting. The XL, which is on display in the PAC aerobatics stand, 16 odd orders at the moment that have, I believe, been paid for. Will be exported through over to Australia once it's already been delivered there.
And some neat formation flying there, Ray, too.
Yeah, so we're just about swinging around in a
Thank you. aircraft after a good breakfast. You've got a strap over each shoulder, one round your waist and one up between your legs. And this is competition aerobatic flying at its best. Incredibly strong aeroplane, and Steve, a very, very accomplished aerobatic pilot. Pulling up, there's about a 4G pull up at the bottom of that, holding the aeroplane, and watch that, straight up, looking out. Aeroplane drops out of that, and at this point, it is not flying, that is tumbling. 1, 4, 5, 5. And it's a mark. Sorted out very quickly indeed. Spatial awareness is called. This aircraft will roll at something around 480 degrees per second. You can just imagine trying to spin round on your own axis. Look at that.
The percent.
Very unpredictable. The stick comes back.
Now, Steve's next maneuver is going to be a torque roll. As he climbs, it's
not. Oh, that's a long shot. The end over, isn't it? And this is one of the reasons why these aircraft have to be so strong, because obviously nothing aerodynamic is happening here.
Just keeping the power on.
And rolling all the way up.
And stopping at the top and then using the torque of the engine to make the aeroplane roll as it comes down tail.
And drops back tail first. And once again, I've lost it in the smoke, so I can't count the number of turns. Sorting himself out, two axes have flown in aerobatic competition. Away from you, towards us.
And watch for the avalanche. Flicks at the top of the lift.
Flick. How uncomfortable. And in advance, aerobatic competition, you're flying in an imaginary box in the sky. You lose points for flying outside the box. And you lose points for inaccuracy when it comes to precise angles. So you're looking at 90 degrees, you're looking at this, which is a 45 degree. Dive, rolls into that, falls up at the bottom, so about 4 or 5G on that, flicking twice on the way up and in the other direction. Those negative flicks. It means that the pilot is experiencing less than their own weight. You know when you're in a lift and the cable breaks and you hurtle down towards the ground floor, you've often felt that. That's negative G.
I must talk to you about that, Jerry. I'm actually had to experience that myself.
Look at the angles. 1, 2. So it's an octagonal loop, and this, you really need to fly this extremely precisely. A little bit of a wind, the smoke's getting blown away, but he's flying those 8 sides. Like this can be flown in stress. It'll cope with up to plus or minus 23G. Which is a lot more than the pilot can cope with. Steve's been flying since he was 16, never flown commercially, never been in the Air Force. He's very much a sport flyer. He also flies some of our Warbirds. This is private for this aeroplane. See. This routine is the result of hours and hours and hours of practice. Finding out what the aircraft can do. What happens when I do this?
Steve was practicing one day last year and he heard somebody in another aircraft call up the controller at Auckland and say, there's somebody with a bloody great model aeroplane.
Look at that precision. Up 1, 2, 3 quarter turns of a roll on a 90 degree climb. We were talking about this 2 years ago.
vertical penetration, which apparently was something you knew quite a lot about.
Yes, but I've forgotten most of it now.
Hanging on the propeller. And this is where power to weight ratio. Dropping back, the nose drops through, bang! And immediately Steve works out where he is, half roll, back onto the axis again. Dropping down, trading height for speed.
Tonight, joining me up here is Mike Revel, who's going to tell you about the aircraft that are trailing the Yaks in the lead, the Nanchangs.
Yeah, the Nanchangs are Chinese aircraft with a slightly smaller engine than the Yaks, 280 apart, as opposed to 300,000 hours. 6,500 on fast ships, 5,500 of those were on the one.
Bigger this aircraft, isn't it? You can tell from the silhouette the length of the wing is a lot longer. A little crank.
Yeah. That's the way, neatly, nice and clean, no wheels sticking out. Pulling up looks like barrel coming up.
Another big difference with the Nanchang is you notice the tail and the rudder. Totally different, a lot more square than the Yak 52, which is a lot more. A lot of people are way into warbirds and way into display flying that finance wouldn't allow otherwise. So it's good for that. Warbirds that you can get two or three friends together and chuck in a couple of books and you can buy one of these.
And there's the rest of the Nanchang team just feeding off the land. We have the leader who is Graham. He's a second officer on a 747-400. He was with New Zealand Air Force.
Well, the Yak 52s. Straight up into a loop. Keep an eye out for Yak 5, John Parker. The yellow Yak. They come out of the bottom. Up from the middle, vertical penetration we talked about it earlier. Four ship heading out to the left of the scene and then coming back down the Yak 52 into the solo routine. John Parker, as I said, started flying off in gliders, progressed to become a B category instructor. Chief flying instructor for Thames Aero Club. Started flying these aircraft in 96. He had the honour of test flying these aircraft when they first come into New Zealand. So, pretty experienced this type of aircraft. Once he pulls up into the vertical, you see what I mean by that speed. It's all about speed management on these aircraft. We haven't forgotten to put the undercarriage up where the aircraft is designed like that, with the undercarriage hanging down underneath. On the left, the wants to make it beautiful, beautiful flight. Look at that box dead straight. Everything, the only guy that's looking forward is the guy in the lead. The other people are picking a point on his aircraft, and as they go into that loop, they're formating on his aircraft. So wherever he goes, the rest of the team will follow. So the four ships heading off to the right, but off to your left. John Parker returning in. Lines up with a display line. Pulling up. Another loop. Yeah. Nose down, he'll re-establish contact with the display line now as he comes through that.
Watch this.
horsepower per engine, 9-cylinder radial.
Windstar 5. Here we go. Straight up. Now this is an impressive maneuver because, like I said, he's not doing that with the sheer power of the engine. He's timed that to perfection. So when he gets to the top of that vertical penetration, he has to start turning soon or else he's going to start sliding back. And he has not got the power to put himself out of it. So that is airmanship of the highest order. His teammates can join in as well. Dark blue with the red trim, that's Kevin Chang. With the advent of cheap flying, we can see these sort of space. Now look at this, this is something I've never seen. This is the inverted fuel system at its best. A lady there in the yellow and red trim, that's Brian Coppersmith. Obviously likes to be the odd man out because he's inverted all the way down.
And I have never seen an inverted pass like that.
Never.
A couple of turns added into it. Great flying. Now you might see all of these hot numbers that fly around here with lots of power, but these guys are really expert.
John's leading it, Kevin. Pulling up. Another good thing about the Yak is it's a proper warbird. There's a big stick between the legs and that's how they control the aircraft. None of this nappy-pappy handles on the side of the army. No one control.
I like this. I like this.
Rest of the team into a loop. That's a beautiful, beautiful loop.
Flying line abreast in formation is one of the hardest things to do. I tried to do it once and gave it away, but doing it in a loop is just something else. It's great flying.
And again, like I said, the two pilots on the outside, they're just concentrating on what's happening in the middle. They're going to follow the yellow flaps underneath. These things could land on an iceberg, I reckon. They're built to last and be thrown around by students. Rough field landing is just not a problem. Very strong aircraft. So first aircraft down, dark blue with the red trim. That's Kevin Jang. Followed in by John Parker. Quite trim and red.
This really is dawn of air fighting.
I have an idea, Jerry, that the triplane is piloted by just the one and only Baron Manfred von
Richthofen. They're under attack anyway. Well, somebody's under attack.
Was castor oil. So as the pilot flew it, he got a great dose of castor oil, and when he landed, he headed for the mess. That's why it's called the mess.
Now, a bit of opposition coming up here now. If you've got cameras loaded, get ready for this, because these two aircraft, flips the bags on the original Marone. What a lovely.
Yes, that rotary engine runs on either one cylinder or up to nine cylinders. The pilot can select the number of cylinders that he wants to operate it on, from about 1/8 throttle through to full throttle.
during that opposition maneuver. Baron, is he gone? It was useful having three wings on a triplane because glues in those days weren't as good as they are now. Quite often one wing would fall off during combat. Still had a couple left to get to know. Very popular pilot, L9,
he's not particularly well constructed. However, let's stop and see if they climb like monkeys and maneuver like the real. And he actually preferred to fly them after a beta fighter came became available.
And the wonderful thing, of course, about this sock with camel painted in the colour scheme of World War One fighter ace, New Zealand declined collar.
Yeah, you were saying, Brody, the number of New Zealand aces from both World War One and World War Two. Numbers, what, 96?
96, the most of any country, in fact, on a per capita basis in the world.
So that's nice. As the World War One scenario lands in, Jan, you're here now to talk about Roaring Forties. And just keep an eye open to that. You've got one or two things to say leading up to that, I think.
Thank you very much, Jerry. Yes, I do. In the combat instructor for New Zealand Warbirds. Number two on the team is Frank Parker. Number three, Peter Horton, who is the Vice President of the Warbirds Association. And number four on the team, one of their team members, Terry Campbell, just last month. In the short time since then, the Roaring Forties team has put together a slightly different display, which they hope is really enjoy. Variable pitch propellers and closed cockpits, and most important, a retractable undercarriage.
None of which existed at the point when these little aeroplanes were developed that we're seeing taxiing down in front of us.
And of course, everybody, if you look at the scarf there that Gene's wearing, the main reason for that was to keep that castor oil off his goggles. It's nothing dashing about it at all, but it's certainly become the symbol of a fighter pilot is the scarf.
You had to be turned on and I had to be turned on.
Well, I suppose that's the first time for everything, isn't there? Yeah. Especially over this weekend.
Yes, the first time Brody's turned me on for ages.
Me as well.
So, Jan, we're just looking over behind us here, and I can see your four aeroplanes. Yes. I'm in the harbour. Still.
Now we've heard about this box loop. A box loop is the big formation in the front with the number four aircraft in behind front. Very, very good station.
With the smoke on today, you should be able to see it looks a bit like a pair of glasses with a tunnel station. Of course, the harbour has a very distinctive sound, a pretty rasping sound, and that is a blast mode. Tip time approaches this thing of sound. For those that are very particularly fine, I want a few quick details about the harbour. It was first flown in 1937. It was powered by aircraft is 37 feet long, with a wingspan of 52 feet, and it weighs 5,700 pounds. That is without a pilot. For the pilot, it is around about 92 decibels. Coming on your left now, we have
read somewhere, Jan, that some of the nicknames used for the Harvard were the Pilot Maker, which stands to reason, Old Growler, which stands more to reason, Window Breaker in the UK, so I don't know how they did that, but Mosquito in the Korean War, that's a more apt description.
That's why I do it. If you watch closely this manoeuvre now, they've come around in box and moving back into the plane. All of these Marbas are painted in the colours as to the time they were used in the Royal New Zealand Air Force. You'll notice perhaps on landing that Gavin's, the leader's aircraft is silver in colour and has a red checker around the nose cowl. That was because the aircraft was used in the original Harvard aerobatic team, the red checkers for New Zealand Air Force.
And the swan formation is leader first, Vic behind the leader. I think sometimes this formation is called leader's benefit.
Giving away any secrets if I tell the crowd that Gavin Fitzgerald actually flew in the Royal New Zealand Air Force Red Checkers team in 1966 and 1967. So the man has a fair bit of experience in
those buildings. Of course, red checkers used to be a standard feature of all the air shows around New Zealand many, many years ago. And in fact, many, many years ago, there was usually only one major air show in New Zealand, which was the Royal New Zealand Aero Club's annual pageant, which actually finished being held in 1990. So it's great to see these old Harvards back with the same kind of routines that were flown by the red checkers in those days.
Yes, it is. The solo aircraft, the yellow one in front of you, that is, once again, in its original colours, a yellow training colour scheme that was used by the RNZAF in the latter years of World War II.
Here's a good example of the barrel roll. If you have a look at the smoke trail in the sky, you'll see that it has traced what could be described as a roll round the inside of a barrel from end to end.
And next, John is going to come past for a low pass from your left to right, so perhaps that's another good camera opportunity. Frank also is a man of very few words. I asked him what he really enjoyed about this. Why did he do it? His reply was because it lifts my balance.
And a wonderful stall turn, lovely slow stall turn from the yellow Harvard.
Thank you. Victor's heart really lies with flying Harvards.
And down into the valley.
Yes.
Look at the Corsair.
The team is coming in for the final manoeuvre.
Lots of photographs of that too, Chad.
First, two, three aircraft will land and then keep moving because they've got people behind. You may see later on when we're recovering multiple aircraft, some people won't want to see. Go around and for landing again, it's called an overshoot. It's quite understandable. Any of the warbirds, when they're in a 3-point attitude sitting on the ground, you'll notice that about all you can see from the cockpit directly ahead of you is a damn great engine. You'll find that there's a lot of leaping left to right. These guys taxi on the tail draggers back lines and see where they're going. Make it very sure they're not going to run into anybody. While we're recovering the harbors. There we are, that's better. And now then, Jurgis Kairys is a lithium gene. Jurgis is booked to 2 points on the airplane that's flying today. It's an SU-31. There's 400 warbirds sitting up the front. I'm telling you this, we've got the roaring horses that are fired. So that's it, we've come by to round the horses in the background. Here we go. Now keep your eye on this aeroplane, ladies and gentlemen. An enormous amount of power. And look at that! Oh. That's one way of taking off over the
upside down under the bridge, did he not set the world on fire?
Yes, he did. And Jurgis does things with this aircraft that's really aerodynamically oriented. So it flies anyway. That's what happens with this aeroplane. But quite often you can see this aircraft tumbling in a way that is absolutely non-aerodynamic. Extremely strong. It's designed to be a brilliant pilot's aeroplane, so any combat could get you doing exactly what you want to do. Look at that, just drop it flat! I haven't seen Jurgis Kairys fly before this weekend, and I was expecting somebody of a very high competition standard to give us what we've seen in the past, where we've had good, really good quality aerobatic competition flying, but in this aeroplane he's showing us exactly the epitome of power over weight. It's a very, very light little aeroplane. Single seater, he's sitting in there, there's a strap over each shoulder. That comes down and meets in a buckle at his waist. He's then got a strap from each side of his waist, one up between his legs, and they are pulled very, very tight indeed. Basically, Jurgis is part of the aircraft when he's flying this. Stick between his legs, gives him control of elevator, ailerons, and then some rudder pedal, gives him control of climbing. Climbing now. Smoke you see on all these display aircraft, it's a tank of diesel. It's pumped until he gets himself set up. He's got a view of the aerodrome and of the display axis.
tweak, tweak, tweak. Now those flick rolls are extremely uncomfortable, and the aeroplane is rolling about its own axis very fast, faster than 360 degrees a second. In this case, it's stalling. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Where's my stick bag? 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and it's picking up as well. Look at that go! At this point during the rehearsal yesterday, I had to go and sit down because it's very, very uncomfortable watching it. So God knows what it's like to fly those maneuvers. And look at this aeroplane tumbling over the top of that. This is all to do. The airframe design is extremely strong, very, very maneuverable. And 400 horsepower sitting up at the front end, giving extraordinarily high power weight ratio. You can see the speed with this straight aerial approach the aeroplane will roll around its own axis. It's this sort of thing where he's hanging on the prop of the car of the aeroplane, he's talking it round. Saying yesterday, this is more like a helicopter. He can hover almost on the prop. Look at that, torque sliding back into his own smoke. Bang! As it comes through. This is extraordinary stuff. Okay, so over the back. Back down towards us on the B axis, although I don't think it displays very much attention to competition as easy as this display. How tightly the aircraft will fit is incredible. Basically, it's limited by the pilot's own G capabilities. This really is the mark of a master, because for all of this tumbling and very, very strange attitudes indeed, man always knows where he is and where his aeroplane is. There we are, nice high speed run. Donk. And my Finch, down the side, thank you. Enclosure, hands up, how many people who would like to be flown for a routine like this? You ought to form a masochist society. Meet afterwards out by the bus. And here we are, over inverted, heading down fast. And push. One. 2, 3, and this is an indication of the amount of power it's got. Very, very controlled, growing maneuvers in the vertical, reaching straight up over the top. There we are, straight to level flight again. The aeroplane is dropping now. Very low forward speed, nose up, A lot of power on there, and he's hovering a bit like a hawk. Pitching down, trading off height for speed. Down towards his display height, about 100 feet. Nobody can resist that, can they? So, pulling up from there, smoke on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Gets up to the top and he's still rolling. But now he's rolling and the aeroplane's going sideways. I don't know how he does that.
Well, look at just a little distraction, folks. All a very positive one. So as they go past, give them a wave. Guys all in the red cap. Some two pilots there as well. Give them a good wave, thanks.
I'm sorry, Jim, I missed that earlier on. I was watching you do a special visit to Dr. Oliver, and that's something perhaps he'd like to fly this routine. What do you think, Buzz? Would you like to fly this routine with Jurgis?
Yeah, sure.
You're sitting alongside...
we'll get Gavin to do it, yeah.
Gavin Johnston, manager of Warbirds Over Wanaka 2004. Give us a wave, Gavin.
Go on, Gavin. Thank you. The buck stops there with Gavin. Year on year, he does a fantastic job. So Jurgis doing his famous side-slip approach. Here he is on the ground. Of course, once he gets on the ground, we can never be certain that his display has entirely stopped. I've got a feeling he's going to end up tucking the aircraft into the centre of the golf pass enclosure, opening the canopy and waving.
Flight in Queenstown. He's been there with them for 10 years.
He's got 400 horsepower. What have we got in the truck?
Well, I think he's got about 1,700. But a little bit more weight to carry, of course. And if he's been eating the curry that I'm ploughing into, well, it'll slow him down a bit more as well. Mind you, curry after a little while can have the opposite effect.
It certainly can. It can speed you up. No end. When Jurgis turned up, we said, by the way, you know you're going to do your routine. Well, we're also having you racing a truck. So can you formate on a truck at about 30 feet? And he said,
no problem.
It is not a problem. Here we go again. There's Jurgis just in that Freightliner. Built that himself, Jim.
Really solid boys, isn't he?
Yeah, just getting it warmed up now, isn't it?
He's only just 6 feet up, I think he's got a lot of
a racing pedigree in New Zealand, of course. He started stock cars, racing saloons, and of course on super trucks, the well-known New Zealand racing name. He's having a ball out there. Powered by Kanapina, six-cylinder, four-stroke, 12-litre C12 engine, developed by and kept by Kanapina Research and Development in Peoria, Illinois. There we go again. Oh, this is wonderful. Now, you go home and show these photographs to people and they're going to say, no, come on, it's all Photoshop. But it isn't. Doing it first.
Talk to me, he's like close to 40, jeez.
Yes, Jurgis, what are you doing over here? Yes, well, that's a very interesting deal, isn't it? Like, you've got to sort of give it to Jurgis in a way of making play when they're doing tight turns and pulling around when he's getting himself sorted.
I'll wait till they all come out.
I think it's the sort of thing that, I mean, we've had, what have we had here before? We've had stock cars and helicopters racing. First time I've seen something like this. So,
there you go.
Hello.
Folks.
Inky is slowing things down a little. He's bringing the Freightliner cab truck.
Oh, hang on a minute.
What do you think?
There's black marks here on the side of the taxi car.
This is your sort of thing on a Saturday night, isn't it, really?
Oh, yeah. That
the other side of Hickey.
Yeah, I'd move,
that might be it. No, I don't believe it is so. I don't believe it is.
Here we go.
So Jurgis is doing his hover approach, sneaking it into a big side slip.
What are they going
to
do?
And then just hop it in there. Oh. Straighten it out.
Doesn't love it.
Out. If either of you two have got hidden speed cameras on you, you are off this site now. Aiming on down. Foot to the floor.
What do they call it?
Pedal to the metal. Pedal to the metal.
Just very quickly, the parents of, well, if Jeremy Simpson, Mr. or Mrs. Jeremy Simpson, were in the crowd, could they please contact one of the ambulance officers, please, or an ambulance station, Jeremy?
Oh, it's the last thing. Yeah, well, we did ask for a collection yesterday from the Gold Pass staff for a new set of tyres for Inky, and I'm very pleased to say you've all been terrified again when you leave tonight. So.
Is a drop zone safety officer for today, and he's giving the team information necessary for prior to jumping, as well as ensuring the area is safe for the lander. So they're coming in now. You can see him, he's popped the smoke, and they're all going to be trying to land as close to that smoke in front of us as possible. As you can see, the parachutes are quite manoeuvrable, even though they're incredibly large. The smoke that you saw coming from the parachute is attached to a leg bracket, which is attached to their leg. And it does burn very hot, so the parachutists don't try and get too close to each other because it would burn the parachute if it came in contact. The team also has a team of professional parachute packers, which are probably one of the most important people today. And that's Sergeant Graham Berry, Corporal Carl Porter and Corporal Pete Lincoln. maybe if you'd like to find out a little bit more about parachute jumping, or in fact any of the other careers in the Air Force, then pop along to the Air Force recruiting tent, which was located just near where the Queen's Air Force parked, and that's where the parachute display team will be about. And as the parachutists are on the ground, we've got the next display from the Royal New Zealand Air Force. The opening maneuver of the sequence is in what's called a bit formation, looks a bit like a V. The red checkers are made up from flying instructors from either of the two Air Force flying schools, which are based at Ahakia in the Manawatu, just beside Palmerston North there. Firstly, we have Central Flying School. The Central Flying School takes pilots that are already qualified on whether it be the Hercules or the Orion or the Iroquois and turns them into flying instructors. Those flying instructors now being formed at the other school known as Pilot Training Squadron. And that's a school if you first join the Air Force and learn to fly, that's where you're trained to fly. And that is also based in Ahakia. Okay, the aircraft are now coming in, still in big formation. They'll be descending down, putting their smoke in, and performing a loop manoeuvre. At the end of the loop manoeuvre, checkers number 5 will then detach the first of its solo segments. Speed at the bottom about 190 knots, about 350 kilometres an hour, down to about 500 feet, and as they go down, up to about 4G. Formations are done with a wing separation in place of 3 metres. There's Checkers 5, detaching the first of a solo sequence. It's first in a position for a curly Q. This is a great way to check how strong your stomach is after a big lunch. Air trainer, which these aircraft are flying in front of us, have been in the RNZAF service since 1998, are a New Zealand built aircraft. So here goes number 5 pitching up. He then does a curly Q, which is like a flip maneuver at the top, tumbles the aircraft. Before pitching back down. Pitch around in a very tight turn and then position for a slow roll in front of us. As mentioned, these aircraft are manufactured by Pacific Aerospace in Hamilton. We actually have a display here today. They're powered by 300 horsepower, like over a slow roll in front of us. Lifting up and slowly rolling the aircraft. Okay, as he departs, we have the other 4 checkers coming in, in what's known as box formation. And they're performing what's called a barrel roll, which, as it suggests, is like rolling around the outside of a barrel. While they're doing that, I'll introduce some of the team. Leading the team is Squadron Leader Walt Thompson, who's the commanding officer of Central Flying School. After 2 seasons in the Checkers, Walt now has the honour of leading the team. And he hails from Dunedin and joined the Air Force back in 1989. He's got a total of 3,500 hours, mainly in the Iroquois helicopter and also the PC-9, which he flew while he was on exchange in Australia. Checks number 2 is Squadron Leader Stu Brownlee. From his hometown of Auckland, Stu joined up in 1990. And he also has most of his hours on helicopters before becoming an instructor. Okay, the aircraft are now coming in and positioning for a loop and box format. Squad leader Nick Pedley RAF way back in 1966. We first flew the Vulcan bomber, later Canberra's, then Jet Provost and Hawks. He had a 3-year exchange over here with the Royal New Zealand Air Force, loved it so much he decided to up sticks and move over and join our Air Force, transferring back in 1986. This is the second year in the Jiggers. If you're wondering where the smoke's coming from, it's coming from diesel that's injected into the exhaust. And as the aircraft come past, it's a good chance to have a look underneath them and see the exhaust and the smoke coming from it. Okay, the aircraft has had a putt to the left. They're going to go into line of stern formation, and they're going to be doing a low pass just in front of us. Again, a good photo opportunity. They'll be quite low, trailing behind each other and coming past us quite quickly. And then separating just over top. Again, a great photo opportunity. Here they come in for their final maneuver to the end of the display. Fan break. Ladies and gentlemen, the red Jiggers. With a C-130 Hercules and the P-3 Orion. So if you look to your right, you'll see these aircraft approaching now. And the 757 is now going to position for its display. I've seen it a couple of times and it's a great display. You often hear of the Air Force regularly being all around the world and flying the aircraft all around the world. Very often the reason they're overseas is in support of our defence personnel. We're currently located in over 15 different countries around the world. From places in Australia to the United States, Iraq, Afghanistan, Solomon Islands, Bosnia and the Sinai and Syria. In order to deploy and redeploy our people around the world, obviously we need transport aircraft. And this role is fulfilled by the C-130 Hercules and what is next to display, the brand new Boeing 757. Although that's aircraft, just how quiet its engines are. First pass, the 757 is going to have its flap at about 20, position 20, and about 140 knots. At full power its Rolls-Royce engines to produce over 40,000 pounds of thrust. I'm told if you attach them to the side, each side of a Hercules, they could lift it vertically off the ground. The aircraft is being captained by the commanding officer of No. 40 Squadron based in Auckland, Wing Commander Tony Davies. And co-pilot is Lieutenant Craig Abella. So here comes the aircraft for its first pass. Master, Sergeant Kenny Murray and the flight steward, Jacob and Derwin Tindall. As I said, 40 Squadron are based in Sunupai. They fly not only the 757, but also the C-130 Hercules, which we'll be displaying later on. Both Tony and Craig, two pilots on board, were the first pilots that delivered the Air Force's 757s when they flew into Wellington on the 7th of May last year. And just last week, we achieved quite a milestone. We completed over 1,000 hours of 757 operations. As the aircraft comes around, soaring again and extending the flight. Incredible just how quiet it is. The 757s were bought from an airline in the Netherlands. The frames were built in 1993. And as mentioned, they enabled the Air Force to meet its obligations worldwide in support of all our personnel stationed overseas. The maximum weight of the aircraft, if you're into facts and figures, is 116 tonnes. Although today the display is being conducted from these 70 tonnes. That's about the weight of 70 of the cars in the car park taking off together. Its maximum range is about 3,800 nautical miles, which is about from Auckland to Hawaii non-stop. Okay, the aircraft's now coming in for a low approach and overshoot in the landing configuration. So the gear's down, the flaps extended, they're coming in quite low and then powering up as it overshoots. And can carry a payload of 23 tonnes. Places where the 757 has been since it arrived in the middle of last year include Scotland, Canada, the United States, Japan, Korea. It also took our Prime Minister and other Pacific heads to the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Nigeria. For its final pass, a high-speed pass, and excellent photo opportunity again to get a picture of the aircraft. So make sure you've got your lens cap off. The aircraft will be doing in excess of 600 kilometres an hour. Now the thing to watch as the aircraft goes past, after it goes past, it pitches up. And it's an impressive sight. It looks like it's almost going vertical. And the aircraft has enough power to actually accelerate in the climb. So here it comes in for its final pass, smoking along the runway. As it pitches up. Looks like it's almost going critical. Awesome sight. And at the top, Tony will just do a large bank turn to the left. Ladies and gentlemen, the Boeing 757. Watching the aircraft, if you are interested in learning a bit more about the Air Force and maybe even want to be one of the pilots or one of the air crew demonstrating that here at Wanaka in a few years' time, Air Force recruiting tent is located.
right-hand end of the display line, beside where the Iroquois and the Naval Sea Sprite helicopter are parked. So the aircraft, just the rejects just conducting a loop, and then as they level out, they will be separating and obviously people will let you hear what the pilot says. Sounds very precision, which obviously with flying, you have to make sure that everyone is very clear on exactly what they do. So as the red check is positioned to come into land, when he's going to be awaiting the arrival of the C-130 Hercules, which will be airborne just before the Hercules come. There they go there. An hour. Full flap extended and about 5 to 10 feet above the ground. Dave Brexel, who's the load master, will have the power door open and he'll be waving frantically in the back. Nose wheel almost touching the ground. Okay, he was looking out the power door, and as the name suggests, the power door, well, it's used for parachutists to jump out of. There's one each side of the aircraft. Kadigbe is now climbing the aircraft up to 300 feet, reducing the flap setting to about 50%, which reduces the aircraft's drag. And he's changed its configuration to that used for load dropping. So what's happening now, they've closed the power doors and they're opening up the ramp. The co-pilot on board today is Flight Lieutenant Oliver Bint, who's a former Iroquois captain. And Flight Sergeant Brendan Clarkson is the flight engineer. Navigator, Flight Lieutenant Dave Newman. Now as it goes past, we'll do a turn there and have a look on the ramp and see the friendly load master waving frantically in the back. I'll see the bicycle in the back there. Now the reason they're wearing white suits, I had a couple of people asking me why they're wearing white suits, and their mental state's fine. It just makes it easier for you, the crowd, to be able to see them as opposed to the normal green ones. Suits there. That was Flight Sergeant Dave Brentzel and Sergeant Dion Forrest, who are the two air loadmasters. Okay, Dickaby's now climbed the aircraft up to 1,000 feet and he's going to conduct what's called a tactical approach. This is used where you're going to an environment that's quite hostile, where people may have guns and weapons where they may want to shoot at you. So you stay as high to the last possible minute, then you pitch down and it looks like the aircraft almost goes vertical. Watch it as it pitches over again. Quite an incredible sight. Woohoo! Digby then descends down, gets on the normal approach, and he's going to carry out a max effort landing. As he touches down, we apply maximum braking and maximum reverse to stop in as short a distance as possible. first seen back along the runway. This sort of technique's obviously used if the ship is, if the landing strip is very short and they use need to make maximum use of it. Now, obviously, the pilot can't see behind him, so you may have noticed that the ramp was open just slightly, the loadmaster looking out and directing the pilot where to go. Big B will now hold the aircraft on the brake to power up to maximum power for a maximum effort takeoff. Staying level, getting the gear up, and then climbing up. C-130s are used mainly for strategic and tactical short to medium range transport, and they can cover such roles as parachuting, airload dropping, where they can drop anything from food and supplies to bulldozers. They can operate day and night at low level, and even conduct the occasional search and rescue. And some of the best bits flying around the world in support of our men and women that are serving overseas. Over the five years, the five Hercules, at number 40 squadron, have seen service in many parts of the world, including the Gulf War back in 91, Somalia, Rwanda, Kosovo, Bougainville, East Timor, and Afghanistan, and also our continuing commitment to the Antarctic program. The Herc is now coming in for a fast pass. We'll be doing approximately 600 kilometres an hour. Again, great photo opportunity.
Russian pilots who flew them in the 1930s. because they had such large paddocks, they can always lay them into wind.
You're actually looking at a stunning achievement by Tim Wallace, the Red Wing team here, along with their Russian partners, to bring the aeroplane back into flying condition. There's been no small feat. Here they are from the left. The I-153 was derived from the I-15, which was the same airframe, more or less, but with a fixed undercarriage. And
whistling at me.
Yeah, I'm whistling at somebody. And in order to deceive the enemy fighters, the I-153 pilots used to lower the undercarriage, lure the enemy in, thinking that they were coming against the slower fighters, and then raise the undercarriage and have a go at them, coming back in from the right.
That was actually quite effective. They used to come in about 250 knots, raise the gear, go to full throttle, and they had a major advantage. We saw the Sukhoi earlier, we've seen Yakovlevs in the past, Yaks, and now the Lavochkin is here for the first time ever at Wanaka. It's flown just occasionally in the UK with the old flight mission company. It took an awful long time to acquire this airplane. It ended up flown by the Chinese Air Force, the University of Aeronautics. The Chinese were operating the airplane as a mission. Well, I'm
public for restoration. The airframe then shipped out. We said to find the aero restoration up in Arsenal. We've got code in touch to report back up the flight.
While we have a moment, we have another lost boy here, or perhaps lost parents would be a better description. Lucas Duncraft from Greymouth. Dad is Greg Duncraft. Would you please meet
under the wings of an I-153. But that's the wonderful thing about coming to Wanaka, to see these sorts of aeroplanes. And I have to say, I think I'd rather see them here than maybe in the snowy depths of Siberia.
I personally would agree with that, although that was interesting. In fact, she's given me quite a little snippets.
The pilot.
Still.
Decided to bring the LA-9 back here. John Levant, sit down on the grass. Just a slight alteration to the program, but where you've got a unique flying aeroplane like this, nobody wants to take any chances at all. John Lamont's a very experienced display pilot, and if he's in any way unhappy with the performance or the handling characteristics of the aeroplane, then what he's done is exactly the right thing to decide to bring the aircraft back. So safely back on the ground. And I'm sure that by the time we're taxiing back down to the hangars, the engineers will be all over the aeroplane and debriefing John to find out what it was that he was experiencing. But a good opportunity anyway for you to see this aircraft as it taxis down in front of you. And I'm just looking out right while that's going on and sitting down to the end of the runway, what looks like an enemy aircraft of our German paratroops who've silently parachuted in where we couldn't possibly see them. Seem to have brought a truck with them as well. These are one of the most vicious enemy aircraft you could ever wish to see. The fact that it flies quite slowly is purely an optical illusion. This thing is flying at over 1,000 miles an hour. No, it's not. Honestly, I was pretending to get a bit. So, LA-9, coming past this here. Not smiling. Probably. Looking back at the ground.
was saying, have a listen to engine noises. Here's a Merlin, and have a listen to this. The 108 doesn't appear to be taking very much notice of that. It's seen the concentration of our ground troops down here. They've got a bit of strafing.
Characteristic of Blonde to give up without a fight.
I don't know, you speaking from experience, Jim?
I'll read your book.
So, well done, war horses. We've got
maybe
enemy Messerschmitts seen off by our American.
ISAC work was done by the restoration of the UK. In New Zealand, it's been, I think, about 4 years getting this aeroplane back to immaculate condition. It's probably better than when it was made in 1950.
Hold nervous for this. Lovely.
side so you can all give them a wave as they run down the line. Spitfires in 48 Fighter Squadron during World War II. All right, we can take off. Yeah,
Corsair? The Hurricane touchdown. Just a couple more comments from Max about the 485 Spitfire Squadron. Tell us where you were stationed during the war, Max, and the sort of sorties that you flew.
We were in England early on, and after D-Day we landed at Cavaquet Airfield in France, and as the Army captured the airfields, we moved up and operated from them. We were doing very close support to the Canadian Army, and as they captured the airfields, we'd just move up and operate from them. They'd capture another one, we'd just keep moving up right through into the middle of Germany.
And you had an encounter with a mini submarine, I believe.
Yes, the Dutch underground told us of a three-vigit submarine off the Shell estuary. So Terry Cairns and I went up, we got the three of them. I think it's the first time, I don't suppose you can shoot down a submarine, so I think it's the first time an RAF has sunk three-vigit subs.
Fantastic. Well, Max Collett, 485 Squadron, World War II. Jack's got a DFC. What have you got?
MID. MID.
What does that mean?
Mentioned in dispatches for meritorious service.
There's the Spitfire. Thank you, Max Collett. Looking left. Said, unlike the American aircraft, you got inside the cockpit, it was all levers and pulleys and, you know, sort of dirty green paint, and they look very crude. Outside, beautiful design.
Well, that's very pretty.
No?
No.
About 3 quarters. Stuart, go to Warbirds Over Wanaka office, please.
Joe, our co-commentator, was making the comment to me earlier about ducks. You get 8 or 9 Spitfires flying along the deck of routine, that'll be something for a whole lot of drinks, isn't it?
Well, I don't think you can ever get tired of seeing the Spitfire in the sky, and when you see it being displayed like this, it's what we were saying earlier, Jim, about the capability of this plane pilot. They're not showing off their own ability, they're showing off the aeroplane. But Nigel's doing that so well. Listen to the sound of that.
As you said, there's two more. As I said before, you tend to wear a Spitfire, you slide into it. Dad made the same comment. Some guys had a bit of trouble with it when he flew to the firm, of course, with the monsoon rains, the runways are frequently boggy and filled with water. They had to put down reinforcing mesh that you use in concrete to stop the aircraft sliding into the mud and nose diving and picking up on a Spitfire. I think it was that town that you dairy farm in the background. Some things you never seem to think you get any trouble flying them, we enjoyed them immensely. Those pilots would have done, no doubt. And down to the right, Spitfire about to land after a fantastic display.
Great, isn't it? It's sort of just blowing everything everywhere for us up here, but we're just sort of two P-40s and the original Warbirds that are going to see.
Here's the cut leader. Japan. Here it is, lovely to see. Along with that, we have two of the P-40 Kittyhawks. I'll interview if you'd like numbers and statistics. One's a P-40 head and the other is a P-40 E. And Graham, the difference is 20 inches. Now, in its role as anti-submarine patrol, the Catalina is chucking out some depth charges.
training in Catalina. He said, yeah, we used to go training off the North Wales coast. Couldn't afford real depth charges during training, so he's
strafed by the Catalina, and who's going to tell them that it's all over?
In all seriousness, the charging of submarine.
And I understand, Jerry, that this is a Goodyear Corsair. And apparently the Goodyear Corsair was one which was favoured by the pilots because it has better visibility due to the nice bulging canopy that the Goodyear people put on board. One of the main modifications of the Corsair during the war was actually to get the pilot to sit higher so that he could see over the nose.
Vent wing design, engineered to keep the undercarriage links as short as possible. It's a very big propeller, this aeroplane, especially when you have the carrier landings. You've got side loads on the gear, keeping those undercarriage links as short as possible.
And talking about carrier landings, apparently in the early days, the US Navy pilots were finding them very difficult to land on the carriers because they bounced a lot, and they often bounced over the arrestor wires. So the US Navy handed it on to the US Marines, who were based on land, so it just helps things a bit more. Here comes the Catalina with its gear down. Remember, none of the New Zealand Catalinas could have done this because they were purely seagoing aircraft.
And Pioneer now has cornered the market in the restoration of the Kittyhawk. Once again, a liquid cooled 12 engine, this time powered by an Alice engine. Very, very capable aeroplane in the role for which it was designed, which was a fighter attack. The teeth on the front of the Hanna Kittyhawk, that's the P-40E, that represents the scheme of the famous American
P-51D
Lovely. And thank you, Elfline Machine Company, and everybody involved for bringing this aeroplane back to New Merlin's.
Chalkboard, I couldn't really explain any more, but it means it goes a long way
but not a lot of effort put in it. Just listen to these Berlins again as they come through. Excelled in that.
100 days is the apocryphal story. We'll build you something better. And this is with the result. These lovely pieces of machinery and are hurtling around for our entertainment overhead. It's a rotten job, ladies and gentlemen. Somebody has to do it.
Thank you. Fear coming down, and again, check it out when it comes into land as the T-28 takes off. A really wide gate on the undercarriage, and very stable on the ground. There you go, he's lying down. Quite a steep approach. Okay, pull him back. There you go. There's a bit of a crosswind today coming from his left, so he's dipped the left wing a little bit.
Whoa.
There you go, that's fine. The size of that propeller, that massive disc.
And now this is a nice one, and very, very pleased to see this, the P-40 Duo, from your left. As I said before, a couple of Allison engines.
Second P-51 down, absolutely on the button. Recovered from an island in New Guinea, or an aerodrome in New Guinea. It's actually several bits and pieces of a Kittyhawk put together, and
the amount of trouble that people have gone through, and especially people like Garth Hogan and Charles Darby, who put this aeroplane together, to actually get the parts, find enough suitable parts to put an aeroplane together and then go about doing it, really got to take the hat off to them. If it wasn't for people like that, we wouldn't have displays like we're seeing today.
So the bird dog comes in, he checks out the battlefield. It looks like there's some soldiers in
the right. I can see that.
Is that submarine this thing?
Yes. They're amphibious jeeps. So we've got the bird dog on the lookout.
Sky Raider.
And you might hear the rather strange noise coming from the Trojan. That's really or merely just a feature of the exhaust system. Aircraft that was developed on the T-37 trainer, tremendous power-to-weight ratio. It can almost lift its own weight with the thrust from the engine. 600 pounds empty with 5,800 pounds of thrust. So, there you go.
we've got artillery working together with the Air Force. Yeah.
Which was staying in practice to be at hand. As well as helicopters with nurses on board.
Oh,
my name is Corey.
It looks like it's a bugger van.
For those of you who can't see, as the shed went down, there is a sign, bugger.
Now the bird dog was holding way off to the right, and the bird dog was also used in the role of helping down the airman. Now we're looking for the jets to come back in.
Good photo opportunity, canopy to crowd shot.
Excellent layout for a ground attack side by side.
And the Roaring Forties team. Point landing though, Jerry.
Yep.
Two main wheels and the propeller. I was looking at that landing. It's a pretty difficult crosswind for an aircraft like that. And you'll notice that the pilot came in with the interwind wheel down, which is the standard way of doing it, especially with a two.
Your mate back again. And the Trojan.
Dihedral on the wings, that's the tilt of the wings upwards out towards the tips. Apparently this assists the pilot in learning to fly these aircraft before going onto jets because it gives similar handling. Right. It looks right. I think that airplane just looks right. It looks like a starfighter, doesn't it? From a distance.
anywhere, certainly in the southern hemisphere, but I don't know that I've ever seen or heard of a Porsche jet display with aircraft of these types.
That's right.
Anywhere else in the world. So please, I hope you've got some film left, ladies and gentlemen. We've got only at Warbirds Over Wanaka. Very nice, very nice. Dragonfly that can sit there in the box at number four and hold his position. And a lovely gentleman this way. And this really is something special. Photographs of this are essential. What do you think of the number of tiger moths in the world?
As short as possible. Great shot there. Get it. And of course the vampire aircraft. You can fix their vampires.
Yep. This is nice. Vampire touche.
This is a combat capable trainer aircraft. Possibly, and I have no fingers to prove it, a more capable aircraft than our Mackie trainers that we have unfortunately got rid of or almost got rid of. The reason that we're seeing aircraft like this now is the freeing up of the availability of military aircraft. I know in the United States they've been having a lot of trouble with the administration so far as having military aircraft in private hands. At least that they're a little bit worried about attacks and things like that. Good fight. But I think they're going to have
this
landscape around Wanaka, the camouflage scheme was just proving too effective. And if you have a look at it, you'll see a skull and crossbones painted prominently on the tail. There's a story behind that. Apparently the artist who painted the skull and crossbones painted a small set on the aircraft because he was related to Captain Morgan. And when the owner of the aeroplane saw it, he wanted it made larger, so he got it painted on the tail. And one thing that really amused me a little while ago when I had a walk around this aeroplane was to see that it had several bullet holes on the side of the fuselage until I rubbed them and found that they were actually transfers. It doesn't break from the vampires. Brett Emily in the lead. And the aircraft painted an RNZAF 75 squadron colours. Paul Hewan tail, number two. The aircraft is painted in Australian Air Force colours because the
40 Spitfire and the Mustang.
That
is the Breitling Fighters displayed.
Reasonable spacing for landing, and it also allows them when they do the pull up to bleed on speed and lower the undercarriage. Most aircraft have a speed at which the undercarriage.
Thank you.
aircraft exactly where he wants. The others, they keep his aircraft exactly in relation to their own. They're not looking up, down, sideways, just the leader's aeroplane. Easier now, you break off into a tail chase. Let's have a look at P-40. Hanna, P-40 leaves in Nigel Lab, Mark 16, Spitfire Lee Bradford, P-51D Mustang, Captain Keith Skilling, flies the Kiwi Hawks, Breitling Fighters.
Shot down already.
anti-aircraft going up, but these guys, as we did in previous years, don't give up without a fight. So we're looking to defend the airfield with everything we've got. They have got armaments, they're armed to the teeth. These T-6s, the London faction, are here again. Somebody's got a slight. Man, there's a lot of shouting going on down here from Consul Major. Thank you. Right. Could be his third. Yeah, look at that. A lovely piece of It's those the curved trajectory that I really enjoy. But it's just go around the corner and follow the aircraft around.
Yeah, they polish one side of the GV.
Just looking down at the alley over there, seeing a couple of the boys the opportunity to get right down, check out any enemy forces hiding down there, but I don't think so. They found the enemy infiltrators. Now last year, boys, those enemy got a really good kicking. Like I said, many of our spray aircraft as we have pilots for, we've got a hell of a lot up here this weekend. As we mentioned, quite coming into quite past.
There is an old filter strip on the other side of the river, which is more of the river.